same problem?
If I could, oh, now it came off. Wait, wait. All right, now the wire's sticking me in the side. You don't want me to be agitated while I'm preaching. That'd make it even worse. Take your Bibles tonight and turn to Isaiah, the book of Isaiah. And it's a pleasure to be here again. I can't believe we're here already. Again, staring Christmas in the face. And Thanksgiving's already over with. And again, for more reasons than one, I'm surprised you didn't find somebody to replace me this year. Brother Cobb, I appreciate you, brother. I've always gotten blessing from your preaching, and I'm looking forward to you carrying me this week, so you help me out. Isaiah, we're going to look at a couple of passages, but I want to just make a couple of remarks about the book of Isaiah. Pretty unique book in the Bible. And the Bible being a book actually made up of other books, 66 books in the Bible. And in the book of Isaiah, you find 66 chapters. And a division after 39 that kind of makes you wonder who put this book together, because in the Old Testament, you have this really harsh, negative kind of picture of God at times, a God of righteousness and judgment. And then, you know, once you hit about chapter 40, things change a little bit, and you begin to see more of mercy and grace than you do probably in very many other books in the Scriptures in the Old Testament. And so as a result, you get some comprehensive pictures of Christ in the book of Isaiah. And I want you to turn to a few of them before we begin to preach tonight. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1. Excuse me just a second. Let me get my water. I have a feeling I'm going to need it. Isaiah chapter 6. And again, many of these are very familiar to you. But Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1 says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple." Now, you and I know that Jesus Christ is right now sitting at the right hand of God, next to the throne, but someday he's coming back. Someday he's going to set up his kingdom in Jerusalem, not the New Jerusalem, but in Jerusalem, and rule and reign with a rod of iron. And there's a picture that Isaiah has for us. And again, a little bit of a harsher picture of Jesus Christ, not the babe in a manger that we generally associate him with at this time. But Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14, we'll look at another one. "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and thou shalt call his name Emmanuel," meaning, and of course that name means God with us. It's interpreted in other portions of Scripture in the Gospels. And then if you will, turn to Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. And again, these kind of fit with the time of year that we find ourselves in, looking forward to celebrating Christmas as Christians and celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. If it weren't for his birth, he never would have had his ministry, his death, his burial, his resurrection. We'd all be in hot water tonight. We wouldn't even be here. I'd probably be dead and in hell if it wasn't for the birth of Jesus Christ. Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 1, or rather verse 9 and 6. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." And of course we know that prophecy was fulfilled. "Behold," "and his name shall be called Wonderful." And certainly many, while he walked this earth, thought of him as being the most wonderful person, so full of life, so full of light. His association, his relationship with his disciples, every one of them, with the exclusion of maybe Judas, would have said that he was a wonderful man, a wonderful traveling companion, a wonderful man, but a counselor. I don't know that I have any examples in the Scripture where somebody came to him for counsel or came to him with a question, seeking it honestly, that he didn't give them the counsel that they needed. Even sometimes his enemies, he gave them wise counsel in spite of the fact that they were against him, and he knew it. The mighty God, he wasn't recognized as such in spite of all the miracles that he worked. The everlasting Father, and obviously that's hard for us to understand, and many don't in the world today, how he makes up the second part of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, how that all works together. But we're not supposed to understand it all. We don't have to understand it all, and that's a blessing to me. I don't have to break my mind trying to figure out and explain or work out in any kind of an algorithm exactly how that all works. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. And it doesn't matter even if I believe it or not, but God said it, that settles it. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And that calls to mind, obviously, the passage where Jesus Christ talks of himself as being the vine, and ye are the branches, that living root that we all spring from. And then in verse 2, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, Spirit of wisdom. He's personified in the Old Testament in the book of Proverbs as wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And as I said, you know, we can go through the book of Isaiah, pick out sections of Scripture like that, and get a portrait of Jesus Christ. And Isaiah, obviously, doing that. Isaiah, his name even means Jehovah salvation. So that Isaiah is pointing to Jesus Christ, although he's prophesying to the nation of Israel. Now take your Bibles and turn to Isaiah chapter 53, and we'll spend a good portion of our time here tonight looking at one particular verse for the most part. And I could read the whole chapter, but for sake of time, I won't. But Isaiah starts out in verse 1, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? And you and I should be count ourselves blessed tonight that we recognized Jesus Christ for who he was. I've told people over the years that the Word of God came to the Jewish people. And I may have even been mentioned here in the pulpit a time or two. Forgive me if I have, but when he came to the nation of Israel as the Word of God, they didn't recognize him. And I don't understand all of that. But I know that when he came to me as the Word of God, I recognized him and acknowledged him. And it's the only explanation I can give you for the fact that I'm here tonight. It's the only explanation I can give to anyone for the fact that any of us are here tonight, is that somehow we saw it, we recognized it, we acknowledged it, and we made ourselves available to follow him. And if you will tonight, look at Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 6, a very familiar verse, where the Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Let's bow our heads and pray before we begin tonight. Help me, if preaching wise, you just pray for me, and I'll pray for my particular part of the service tonight. But Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, again tonight for your goodness to us. Lord, I thank you, God, for getting me up here safely. Any number of things could have happened on the way. And Lord, I don't know how often we take for granted, Lord, that you just get us from one place to another, bring us back and forth, carry us here and there, and we do so, you know, without even giving thought to it, God, but we get there safely, safe and sound. And I pray, God, for this church, Lord. I pray for Brother Nagalski and his family, Lord. I know they're dealing with problems and issues and the people of this church, that you'll bless them at this time. They have sought to set aside some time here when everyone is busy and everyone could be busy, God, and lost in thought about other things in regards to the Christmas season other than concentrating on you. And I pray you'll bless them for setting aside some time. Bless this meeting, God. Brother McGahee coming in at the end of the week, and Brother Cobb, I know he's open and already preached a couple of times, Lord, but give these men the unction that they need to preach. And Lord, for my part, God, help me to fit in, help me, Lord, bear witness to what I have to say tonight and in the coming nights. But I pray that you'll bless the services, bless the preaching, bless the music. And all of it is a blessing to us, Lord, because of you. And may you receive honor and glory from it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In this verse that we look at, obviously Isaiah is preaching to or prophesying to the nation, Judah. And of course, we could take the history of the nation of Israel and Judah and set it down over the United States of America almost like a template. I mean, we have followed them for the most part in lockstep, except maybe we've even gone farther down than they have. They had times when they got away from God, and then they came back to God. They got away from God. They came almost in a circular motion, almost like a wave. But I don't know that America has gotten away from God and ever gotten back to God. I mean, we've made some attempts at it, I believe, in the history of our country. But have we really gotten back to where we were at one time with God. I highly doubt it when I look at it. But of course, he's not prophesying just to a nation, because individuals make up nations. Tonight, if we, well, and we are at war somewhere around the world, it's not just the United States of America at war, it is the individual people. Although we may not recognize it because we haven't seen it on television lately, we're involved in everything that the United States of America stands for, and some of it is good and some of it is bad. Some of it is God-honoring, and unfortunately, most of it is not God-honoring. And it's what brought us to the position we're in today as a country. But here Isaiah says, all we, like sheep, have gone astray. And I guess my first point, the first thing that I want to point out is that this is inclusive. All takes in everybody. Oh, we had a preacher that used to come into our church at Calvary where I got saved years ago, over 30-some years ago. It's hard to believe. And he preached a message one time, and I don't know if it was from this passage or what passage it was, but he made the statement. He just repeated it over and over and over again. It's one of the reasons why I still remember it. And many of the people that were in those meetings still remember it too. And he used to say this, all means all, and that's all that all means. You wouldn't think I could quote that, but that's almost like that McDonald's commercial, you know. Only I can't quote that. But all means all, and that's all that all means. But you know, we're pretty much like the people of any nation, the nation of Israel included. We try to slip out from underneath the preaching any chance that we get. You know, if there's anybody else that could be hit by the preaching, you know, we try to deflect whatever is being said rather than take it to heart for ourselves. We try to look around and see if anybody else is being affected by it, just because we don't want anybody to know that we're being affected by it. But I'm telling you tonight that Isaiah is preaching, not just to the nation of Israel, but he could just as easily be pronouncing this prophecy over the United States of America. And by that I mean putting his bony finger in the face of each and every one of us. He says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And I don't know if he declared it like that. When I read it, it doesn't quite come out that way. But I'm just telling you tonight that God is not pleased with us from time to time when we stray, when we get away from God. And I dare say, I know who I'm speaking to. I'm preaching in a Baptist church. And as Baptists, we get away from God. Quite often, we use this as a passage to bring a lost sinner, someone that's out in the world, back to the knowledge of the fact that they need a Savior, to recognize the fact that they're sinners. But sometimes we lose sight of the fact that we're sinners, still are, still do, still get away from God. We're not nearly as close to God as we think we are. That's a thought for you. I haven't thought about that for a while. And it's quite an indictment on us that we get away from God. What excuse could we possibly give for getting away from God? And I know you love the Lord tonight. And I know we put the emphasis on that. And I love the Lord tonight. But you know, when we read this verse, there's a problem with it. And the problem that we have with it is that we're sympathetic. But we're not sympathetic to the Savior. We're sympathetic to the sheep. Isaiah says, all we like sheep have gone astray. And you know what? One of the problems in the Christian life is this. We put the emphasis on the wrong syllable. And things don't come out right at times. And sometimes we read a passage like this, and we forget about the all, the we, the everyone, the us, and the me. And we read, all we like sheep. Now, if you're down south, you'd say, we all like sheep, or you all like sheep. But that's not what Isaiah is saying. Isaiah's not saying we all like sheep. I like your good Euro sandwich as much as anybody. But Isaiah's not referring to a Euro sandwich or a leg of lamb or anything of that kind. He's not talking about something put on the table or the fact that, you know, he's got a herd of sheep and he likes sheep because of the commerce that it creates. And as a result of that kind of thinking, I'm going to tell you what the world does. They look at us and they watch us and they see us like sheep. But then they have questions about the shepherd. I mean, these questions that if there is a God, why is there a war? If there is a God, why is there famine? If there is a God, why is there poverty? If there is a God, why is there suffering in the world? And if you do any personal work at all, you know, you've run into those questions. Those individuals, well-meaning individuals, think they're posing a question to stump you with. And of course, the obvious answer is, listen, the reason there are those things is because there are sheep like us in the world. It's not the shepherd. But we're sympathetic to the sheep. We sit here tonight, we're sympathetic to the sheep more than we are to the shepherd. And it would just take simple illustration to prove that to you. Listen, suppose that you lived out in the country. And this isn't, you know, this is hard to get to, but it ain't country. Suppose you lived out in the country somewhere here in Michigan. That's where you wanted to live. And you lived out in the country, and in your vicinity were farm fields, you know, a lot of hilly land, These dirt roads, but they're kind of curvy, and you don't have to be in a hurry to get anywhere most of the time. But you live out in the country, and you drive by, and there are shepherds, or there's a man who has some sheep in a pasture, and you drive by that pasture every day. And I'll tell you, if you have that, that's a blessing. Be able to drive from the country into the city to work, or to drive someplace to work, and be able to have that scenery to appreciate. I mean, the Lord created all of that for us, and it's beautiful to behold at times. But if you drive by and you see those sheep, you know, you can appreciate it. But suppose some morning you're driving into work and you're not necessarily in a hurry, come up over a little rise and down into a little gully, and maybe you go around a little curve, and you're going by that pasture field, and you almost don't notice that there's a sheep out in the middle of the field. And, you know, you don't think, oh, boy, you know, roadkill. You don't automatically get on the accelerator and think, well, okay, we're going to have Euro sandwiches tonight, or we're going to have a leg of lamb. You're not looking for, you have sympathy for the sheep. So you stop the car, take it out of gear, put the parking brake on, you get out, and you try to get the sheep off the road so he doesn't get killed. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's a dumb animal. And so maybe you accomplish the task, and you go on to work, and you're not late, and there's no great big problem that was caused because that sheep got out. And maybe you don't have another incident for, say, let's a week or two, and then you come, you're going again that morning, and you come around the bend, and you come to the same spot, and there's that sheep. Maybe there's one or two more sheep out in the middle of the road. You know, they don't belong in the road. What are they doing in the road? Somehow they've found a way out of the pasture. They've gotten out where they don't belong. They've gotten into a place where it's dangerous for them to be, but they're an inconvenience to you. But at the same time, you don't kill them. You have mercy on them. So you stop your car and you get out and you chase all three of them back. Maybe you try to find find the place in the fence where they got out and get them back in. But you get them off the road so they don't get hurt. And then maybe, again, you know, you come home back and forth a couple of weeks, no more incidents with that sort of thing, kind of forget about it, and then you're coming down one day and you're a little bit late. You got your coffee in your hand in one hand, you got your bowl of cereal in the other hand. I don't know how you're driving, but you're coming down across there, and you notice you're looking out across the field, and you almost don't notice five or six of them out in the middle of the road, and you have to get on the binders and you stop the car. But this time you're a little bit upset because you're late for work. It's really getting to be quite an inconvenience for you now, but you're still sympathetic for the sheep. You don't slaughter the sheep. And the conclusion you come to after you do that two or three times is this. You start to get upset with the shepherd. And you start to say to yourself while you're getting the sheep off the road, stupid shepherd. Stupid shepherd can't keep his sheep in. See, the sheep don't get the blame for it. Are you following me tonight? Listen, all we like sheep have gone astray, but I'll tell you who gets the blame for it. That's why you get those questions. Why, if there's a God, why is there a war? Well, there's a God. There ain't any question about that. And if there's war, it ain't because God caused the war. It's because man caused the war. God's been trying to stop that war for thousands of years now. And he's got a solution for it. He's going to stop it by force one of these days. And we read the passage about it. So what does the Bible say about it? Here in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 1, here's what the Lord has to say about it. Through Isaiah, at the beginning of this book, he lays it all out. the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amoz, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, but we could say in the days of the United States, in the days of whatever nation you wanted to put in here and fill in the blank. In verse 2, he says, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken, I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me." It's a shame, but when God likens us to being sheep, he doesn't liken us to being sheep because they're fluffy and they're white and they're warm and they're fuzzy and they make nice blankets. I mean, that's not the reason God likens us to sheep. There isn't any backslapping going on here on the part of Isaiah when it comes to the Lord saying, all we are like sheep. No, it's because they're dumb. And if you've ever raised one, you'd downright say they're stupid. It's because they're dirty. You know, a sheep can't clean himself. A sheep can't, he relies on the shepherd to clean him. Now, you ought to be getting a picture, just like we saw of Jesus Christ in Isaiah when we read, he has no discernment whatsoever. You know, that's why when you're driving to work, one sheep got out and three or four more of them followed him. They have no idea what they're getting into or getting out of or getting away from. They have no sense of direction. One of them takes off one direction, they'll follow, but they don't know which direction. They get lost very easily. I mean, I can see the similarities myself every time I drive up here. I'll see it. I'll write another chapter tonight when I go home. You could get me out here and driving me to Detroit. I know I'm going north, but there are times when I believe I'm going west and I'm going east, and there are even times that I think I'm going back south. I mean, they have no sense of direction. They get out, and they can't get back because of no fault of their own. At times, it's just their nature. And when God likens us to being like sheep, listen, if they roll over on their back, they can't even get up. Now, you may have never experienced that, but that's just a case of being in a helpless situation. And I've been there, like sheep. All we, like sheep, gone astray. And I know I'm preaching to Christians tonight. I know I'm preaching to people that love God. I know I'm preaching to people that have a testimony. But you just answer in your own heart, have you gotten away from God? In the last 365 days, we're staring another new year in the face. And I know, you know, we all get retrospective? Is that the word? All right. We all get kind of retrospective. That doesn't sound right, but I'm going to use it because you said it was okay. We all get kind of retrospective at the end of the year, looking back on what we've accomplished for the Lord or how faithful we've been to him. And I just never can put too many marks beside my faithfulness. I just really can't give myself too many attaboys at the end of the year, but I can always look to him and see how faithful he was. And we're like sheep because of their character. Because every one of those things that I described right there, that's the character of a sheep. It's how you know they're sheep. It's how you would describe them. And it determines their conduct. And the fact that we're sinners. I know we're saved by grace. I know we're cleaned up here tonight. I know the Lord has sanctified us. He's put us in a place of where we can serve him, and he uses us from time to time. But we're still sinners saved by grace. We are still, like the old song says, prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. And you know, it just doesn't take much at times. He says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. You know, I can imagine in my own mind a mother getting up some morning, going to her son's bedroom, maybe finding a note, a piece of paper, laying on a pillow. But she knows in her heart when she walks in there, he's gone. You know, maybe it's a wife, and she's been working, and she comes home one evening, and her husband's not there, and she knows he's gone. They've been having some words. Maybe it's the husband, and he and his wife have been having some words, and he comes home from work, and she's gone. all we like sheep have gone. I think that's one of the loneliest words in the English language. I've known some young men whose parents have raised them like the Lord spoke about in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 2. And they rebelled. And they just lived for the day when they could leave home. They lived for the day when they didn't have to sit at the Father's table anymore. They didn't have to follow His rules. They thought they were going to be able to do whatever they wanted. And I don't know how far away many of them got, but I know some of them have gotten too far away. But I know the ache in the heart of the mother and father, not personally myself, but I can sense it. I can sense it myself, knowing when somebody's gone. And they are not coming back. And you know how that's how the Lord sees it. He has done everything that He possibly can do for us. And in spite of that, every once in a while, He'll come looking for us where He expects us to be. And we're gone. We're not there. We're missing. And I know the Lord has foreknowledge. I know the Lord has knowledge that goes beyond our imagination. I know He knows everything. Let's put it that way. But it's still going to cost Him something. Even if He gets you back. And I will say this, none of us know. Anytime we do take leave, whether or not we're going to make it back. We never do. I've got a daughter that's gone to live in Arkansas. She's serving the Lord, and I just thank God for it. I got a couple of daughters that are living still with us, and they're serving the Lord, and I'm thankful for it. But that doesn't mean tomorrow they couldn't be gone. That doesn't mean there couldn't a heartache come into their life because they're sympathetic for the sheep. But they couldn't turn their back on the Savior. I remember when I turned my back on. I remember as about an 11 or a 12-year-old boy, and my dad stopped going to church. And we weren't going to a Bible-believing church that had singing like this or the Bible being preached like this. We were going to a Methodist EUB, kind of a conglomeration of things, kind of a free-for-all. Not that I didn't learn some things from the Word of God and get an appreciation for Jesus and who He was. I learned a lesson so valuable that I carried it with me throughout my life. Kept me out of a lot of trouble as a young man growing up. But I'm just saying that I remember making that decision and that choice to stop going, to stop learning about Jesus Christ, to stop entering into His courts with praise and stop going into the presence where there were some godly saints in that. There was a man in that church, I remember, Porter Dennis was his name, I'm telling you. He sat on the back row, and every once in a while they'd call on him to pray. They didn't call on him that often because, to be honest with you, he shook the building. He put everybody to shame. When he prayed, the entire church was transported into the throne room of God. I've known a couple of individuals like that in my life that could really get a hold of God on a moment's notice. These young men, these young ladies, that husband, that wife, they're gone. A lot of times they think they're just on their way. Young men, young ladies especially, they're going somewhere. I remember myself, I thought that, I knew how to run my own life. When I was driving up here today, I ran into a couple of dead ends. I used one of them just to turn around and change directions. I knew if I turned down there, I wasn't going to get anywhere, but it provided me a place to turn around and change directions and come back the same way that I'd come, because it became obvious to me that I'd taken a wrong turn. I wasn't lost yet, still had my bearings, but it's so easy just to take a wrong turn. There's nothing wrong with coming to a dead end and using it the way God expects us to use it. The Bible says there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. How often I have to be reminded of the fact that, man, if I keep going the way I think is right, it's going to lead to a dead end. Several weeks ago, I ran into a young man that, well, he's not young anymore, but I used to work with him I used to build silos in grain elevators, poured concrete, 6-8 feet a day. I think we had to make, it was probably 6 feet a day. We had to pour 6 feet a day, brush down a silo. A lot of times you were 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 feet, 100 feet in the air. And you were around this silo working on it. And I was at a funeral several years ago, and this fellow's mother came to me, and she told me that her son had gotten saved. And I thought to myself, that it just didn't register. Because it's been 40 years since I've seen him. But I've been waiting to see him. I've been waiting to run into him to see if his life had really changed. And I was at nursing home visiting my mother this last 2 weeks ago. And she had arranged, this fellow's mother had arranged, her husband is in the nursing home where my mother is at. And I had seen her down there a couple of times, and run into her again. And she told me that Dan was coming. He was going to be there. They were going to have a Thanksgiving dinner after Thanksgiving, but they were going to have a Thanksgiving. He lives down in Columbus, a couple miles away. He doesn't come up every week. And he said he'd like to see you. And I thought, well, that's encouraging. Some of the old friends that I worked with wouldn't be too keen on seeing me now that I'm saved. I mean, I've taken opportunity at times to witness some of the fellows that I ran around with in school, and a few of them showed me the door. They didn't want anything to do with me after that. Maybe I was too harsh in my witness. I don't know, but I just tried to show them what God had done for me. And I was kind of encouraged by that. And I got down there in the nursing home the other day, and I walked by a fella, and I didn't recognize him. And I turned around, and I walked back, and he didn't recognize me. And then after I kind of looked at his build a little bit, and I thought, you know, I bet that's him. And so I called his name, and he turned around. He recognized that somebody was calling him, and we had a wonderful time of fellowship. And we talked for a little while. He didn't talk too much about church or being a Christian. Every once in a while, entered the conversation. After a while, I just said, point blank, I said, you got to tell me how you got saved. Because I'm looking at a young man that it's hard to believe, you know, that kind of thing. And myself, too. I'm sure he's looking at me thinking the same thing. I said, you got to tell me how you got saved. And he went out, long story short, somebody witnessed to him on the railroad. He's working on the railroad, sleeping in his car, and just crazy the way people live sometimes, away from God. And somebody witnessed to him, took him to their home, and he got saved. He just trusted Christ same way that I trusted Christ, same way that you trusted Christ. He just came back into a place of safety. He'd had enough of being out there on the road, and he came back to the place of safety. He was gone, though. I'm telling you, I knew that young man, and he was gone. A lot of his companions and a couple of those young men, one of them's dead now. He told me that he'd witnessed to him, and I was really encouraged by the testimony that he had. He's running a soup kitchen down in Columbus, and the Lord's given him something to do, and he's attending church regular. They had a little split down there, and when I asked him, you know, what was the problem, he didn't want to give me any particulars. He said, oh, just a division. He almost was talking like a preacher. Oh, just division. And you know, that pretty much boils it down, doesn't it? When we have trouble in the church, somebody gets out of sorts, just a little division. Somebody gets out of the way. But all we like sheep have gone astray. You know, the world isn't too much different than we were when we were young men growing up. The world we're dealing with today. We look at these young people and think, oh, they're so much different. So many more pressure. No, it's just a matter of recognizing the fact you have a shepherd who is a savior on top of everything else, and you need him, and we need him now as much as we did. I mean, I need him more now. I look at the world now, and I think, how in the world does the world go through even what little I've been through and deal with it? How do they? And Isaiah says, who hath believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? I can't answer that question. God reveals himself to the world, and some receive and some reject. And I don't think it has anything to do with how far gone they are. Because if I had to describe that young man, I'd say he was gone about as far as anybody could go. And I've known individuals in my life who were way out there. He says, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. Even up in the year 2016. But I mentioned turning down a dead end because, you know, I made a wrong turn. It is so easy to make a wrong turn. You don't even need a Google map to make a wrong turn. The directions tonight didn't even help me somewhat. I got to one of the directions and it said you're supposed to take, you know, such and such a route north. Well, I got there and there was only east and west. So, you know, it was kind of a toss-up. I thought, well, here we go, Lord. You know, and the Lord helped me. I was on the right one. I didn't get turned around that time. But it's so easy to get turned around. I remember years ago I was a truck driver. And I drove for a little farm concern. The trucks were rickety, and you risk your life every time you got in them. And the first day, I mean, I learned how to drive the truck by getting in the truck and following my boss up to Toledo to Nabisco, one of the, not a refinery, but a granary up there. And the second day, I thought, well, I'll do the same thing. I'll get over there, I'll get my truck fired up, and I'll just follow my boss to work. The only thing I didn't consider was the fact that he got up a lot earlier than I did. You know, I thought the day started at 8 o'clock, and he got up about 4 to get on the road and beat the traffic. I was still learning. So I realized, well, I'm going to have to make my way up to Toledo. I can't just leave this truck sit here. I want to get paid for a day's work, so I'm going to have to take this truck by myself. And, you know, straight I-75 is a straight shot. I do believe, brother, if this church was on I-75, I don't think I'd have any problem getting here. You give me a route with 75 on it, and I can get just about anywhere I want to go. It's pretty much a straight shot. But I got up to Toledo, and I realized I knew I had to get off at Front Street. And I turned, got off the exit there, and I started driving up. Man, I was feeling pretty good about myself. I thought, man, I made it all the way up here without my boss. And I'm driving along, and I'm looking out the window, and I'm thinking, man, I'm enjoying the scenery and driving this big 18-wheeler. You know, you feel important when you're sitting up there and you got all this truck behind you. And I got to looking around, and I thought, I thought, you know, maybe I'm wrong, but, you know, yesterday I could have swore that the river, which is over here, was over here when I was driving following my boss. I thought, well, maybe I'm confused. I'm just disoriented a little bit. And I thought, no, I kind of shook that thought off a little bit. And I got farther and farther towards Toledo, and I realized, boy, nothing looking too familiar down here. And that river really is bothering me. And I got closer and closer, and then I saw the buildings start to rise up and get bigger. And I finally wound up right downtown. And I'm telling you, the trucks that we drove, they didn't exactly pass inspection a lot of times. I was driving a cab over International with straight pipes, you know, no mufflers. That is not something you want to have downtown. You know, with a sound chamber, the big buildings. And we don't have a lot of big buildings. But I'd let off that accelerator, and that truck would go, blah, 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 blah. And it wasn't 4 o'clock in the morning. It was noon. All the people out on the street, all I could think was, oh, I'm going to get arrested. Somebody's going to notify the police that there's a truck downtown leaking grain on the road and making a lot of noise and ruining everybody's day. I just didn't know what to do. I mean, I was helpless. You can't just turn an 18-wheeler around downtown. And besides that, it was only the second day I'd been driving. I wasn't turning it around at all. You know, I've driven that route a couple times. There is no place to turn one around down there. But I got to thinking in my mind, and I got to believe it was the Lord helping me out. I got to thinking there's got to be another bridge crossed here, this river. Got to be a bridge across the river. And I probably passed it, but there's got to be more than one. Certainly in a town the size of Toledo, there's got to be more than one. And lo and behold, I come up to Cherry Street. And of course, if you don't know Toledo, and you don't know Toledo, but there's a Cherry Street drawbridge. And I thought, whoa, Cherry Street, I recognize that. Cherry Street drawbridge, and I thought, man, I am hightailing it across the river. I am turning right here. But there was a bunch of blockades up and a bunch of people working. And I thought to myself, you know, I don't even know if the bridge is up or down. I don't know if the bridge is in
I don't know if you can drive across the bridge right now, but I had it in my mind this. Either I was going to get across that bridge, I was going to make the right turn and get where I belonged and deliver my load, or the headlines in the paper tomorrow was going to read, Country Boy Dies Driving Off, you know, Bridge, Cherry Street Bridge in Toledo, Ohio, Drowns in the River. It's so easy to make the wrong turn. And you know what I've learned over the years? Sometimes you make another turn and you just get more and more lost and more confused. That day it worked out all right, but it doesn't always work out that way. Sometimes we spend a good deal of time in a lost condition or confused in our Christian lives about what we really should do and how we can right what we've made wrong. And we spend a lot of time here talking about the sheep, talking about ourselves today, which is what we do a lot in the Christian life. But the Bible says here, and. And is a conjunction. I'll give you a little English lesson. It connects things. It marries the first part of that phrase to the second part of that phrase in that verse. And what the Lord Jesus Christ did was he laid on him the iniquity of us all. And the Lord laid on him, and he joined himself to us. He came to us where we were. He came to us when we were lost. You know, I've kind of entitled this message, One Good Turn Deserves Another. You've heard that phrase, haven't you? Listen, when he came to me, he did me a good turn. In spite of the fact that I turned away from him and went away from him, listen, he did me a good turn. You know what I've learned over the last 365 days? You know what I've learned over the last 30, 35, 40 years being saved, now that I'm a child of God? Even when I stray from him, he still does me a good turn. He still seeks me out. He still comes to me. He still speaks softly to me. He's sympathetic with me when I'm not sympathetic with him. Listen, there was a time when I needed to be saved. But I still need to be saved for myself a lot of times. My sense of direction, all those things, all those descriptions that I have of the sheep, those all describe me, and they all describe you to the T here today. And I guess to kind of wind this thing down, turn to Micah chapter 7 and verse 19, and I'll read a couple of more verses from Psalm. From one of the Psalms, Psalm 103. And verse 10 and 12, he says, He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Isaiah 38, 17 says, Behold, for peace I had great bitterness, but thou hast in love to my soul delivered it from the pit of corruption, for thou hast cast all my sins behind my back. He's done us more than one good. In spite of the fact that as a young man, I turned my back on him and went my own way. He saved me from death. He saved me from hell. Boy, I can testify with the psalmist David in Psalm 40. I can testify with him. But in Micah chapter 7 and verse 19, he gives the nation of Israel hope in a prophecy here. He says this, He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities, and thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. One good turn deserves another. You know what I found out about the Lord? He's eager. He's more than eager. He's willing. He's ready to turn to me. But often I'm the problem. I'm not willing to turn to him. I see him sometimes as Isaiah prophesied him in the first part of the book of Isaiah. I know there's judgment coming. I fear chastisement. But too often, like the prodigal son coming home, I found it not to be a true picture of my Savior and my Lord Jesus Christ. And I look at this meeting as an opportunity for us to prepare for the new year that's coming, to focus our attention on Jesus Christ, to become to get refreshed spiritually. And when we come to these meetings, we don't always know how God's going to deal with us. And I don't necessarily want to force anything upon you in the way of responding to an invitation or that sort of thing.
But it's your turn. It's our turn. In these last days, it's our turn to show the Lord how much we love him, by what we're willing to put up with a lot of times, by our willingness to follow him, by our willingness to be faithful to him, in spite of the fact that many aren't. Many aren't. I'm going to ask Brother Nagolsky to come.